José Morales Arilla. I'm a G4 in the Public Policy Program here at Harvard. My fields of specialization are political economy and development economics. Lately, my work has focused on Venezuela. On the one hand, assessing how community-organized soup kitchens erode the capacity or the reliance of people on the government's sort of clientelistic food distribution networks. And more lately, especially given that we just turned 1 year after the big blackouts that occurred in Venezuela in March last year. So we observed that the blackouts were, you know, nationwide, definitely, but we found that not only was the blackout stronger in the northwest of the country, but the northwest of the country has remained with, you know, after the blackouts were over, it's remained with the sort of most unreliable access to electricity after the blackouts. And the reason for that is that there is an over-reliance currently in the Venezuelan power system on power generated in the Guri hydropower dam, which is a really really big hydropower station that is in the southeast of the country. And that is, and the rest of the country connects through it through transmission networks with very unreliable access to the service, and you know, which, you know, given that electricity is a general purpose technology, the main example of a general purpose technology, it affects everything downstream. So access to water, access to public illumination, and you know, everything. When you have unreliable access to electricity, gets affected. So the city itself has deteriorated in the last year in a way that is almost, it's very hard to describe, and it's, you know, it's, that's like kind of the story that connects this idea that places that were more distant from the Guri dam, especially the ones that rely on a particular segment of the transmission network, were the ones that were most affected initially by the blackout, and that after the original blackouts have been suffering from more aftershocks, to put it in some sense. There's been conflicting narratives, right, as was expected, right? Like the chavismo, the regime, has sort of been pushing this idea of sabotage, which is kind of, you know, connected to the narrative that they were pushing about the ongoing economic crisis that had done away with 70% of GDP in the country, which was like the economic war, right? Like the opposition are the lackeys of the American empire, and you know, they are the ones causing the crisis, and we're waging this economic war against this imperial power. And the narrative of the opposition, or as you might say, the narrative of the interim government, was that this was a maintenance issue. So, and there were all these pictures of the power, you know, the cables are held up by some towers, and there were all these pictures of these towers, you know, with weeds going all the way to the top. And the idea is that, you know, these things get very hot because there's like transmission of energy that's dissipated through heat. And, you know, that might have led to a fire. Just, you know, it's not like the regime purposefully let, you know, produce the blackout, but that there was an accident, but the accident was induced by poor maintenance of the network. I really believe it was exogenous, right? Like it was not the, you know, while it could have been like sabotage or it could have been just an accident, you know, what I do believe is that it was exogenous in the sense that no economic agent was expecting and preparing for it, or political agent was expecting and preparing for it. But I think the experts are, you know, tend to side a bit more with the interim government narrative about it, right? Like the there is this sense when you talk to the Venezuelan experts on the power grid that, you know, this was not a question of whether it would happen, but when it would happen, right? Like the way it's been managed. So then this was the sort of fire that led to the disconnection of this point of the huge point of demand and the main point of supply, which made the whole system to go down. That was a fire that occurred in that transmission line. So that's a transmission line that once everything got reconnected was also more vulnerable. And that's why the aftershocks have also been hitting hardest in the northwest of the country, right? Like the places that got, not only at the original shock, but later on have remained with very vulnerable power supply, have been Maracaibo, San Cristobal in the Andes, Barquisimeto, sort of in the northwest. So it's that area of the country. And what we find is that on the political response side of it, protests spike in those areas after the blackouts themselves. If we say that in the Venezuelan context, the protests are the measures of democratizing pressures, we do see that those protests spike in the places that got hit hardest. So that's consistent with the literature. But the fact that we have a very, detailed data on protests, both at the time, in a temporal sense, but also in a geographic sense, allows you to test how these democratic, like the mechanisms of the democratic window of opportunity. And what we find is that not only is the opportunity limited in time, so we see that the protest activity converges, the protest spike that is seen by the places that were affected hardest, converges to the same level of other places in the country in about 2 months. So it's a very limited window of opportunity in terms of time. And actually, the effect seems to be negative in places that got hit hard by the blackout, but where the regime had high electoral support at baseline. It seems that the networks of the regime get activated in the blackout so as to prevent mobilizations that in theory would have been triggered by the blackout and were indeed triggered by the blackout elsewhere in the country. Another interesting aspect is that after the blackouts, the regime has placed a special attention, priority, and resources to protecting Caracas. So right now, Maracaibo, which is, as I was saying, a rich and big city, they have blackouts almost every day, but Caracas very rarely has blackouts or brownouts or just disruptions in the power system. And this you see also in other dynamics, also like access to gasoline. It's access to fossil fuels is very, which is a contradiction for Venezuela, but access to fuels is very scant everywhere else in the country, but in Caracas they've kept a provision rather steady. And the idea, the logic for that is very simple, right? Like the regime falls or stays is, that action happens is in Caracas, right? Like the biggest fear for the regime right now is a huge uprising in Caracas that could do away with their hold on power. So they're trying to prevent that, and to do that, they're devoting most resources to keep Caracas well provisioned for. So something that we've started to see as a response after the blackouts is that there's been a huge migration of people from other places in the country into Caracas. It's people trying to escape from the aftershocks and from the new reality of life in Maracaibo, or new reality of life in San Cristobal or in Barquisimeto, like the northwest of the country that got hit hardest. And that's what we're observing, that the strongest rates of domestic displacement into Caracas are coming from the areas that were hit hardest by the blackouts. One big thing that the regime did 1 month after the original blackout was that they enacted a rationing schedule. And then they basically said in different municipalities or in different parishes in the country, that these are going to be assigned to rationing from this time to this time, this day of the week. But some parishes and some municipalities in the country were saved from that rationing schedule. There is a question of whether the rationing schedule itself binds, right? Like whether actual access to electricity matches what the government said would happen starting on that date. But at least we think that this rationing schedule is a measure of like a revealed preference of the government in terms of the areas where they hope, now that you have a limited capacity to supply the whole country, where do you want to place the priority? And obviously you're going to be more likely to assign a place to rationing if that place got hit hardest by the blackout, because that initial hit is indicative of your later capacity to supply through these transmission networks and all this stuff. But if you're able to, using econometric methods to residualize or to control for the vulnerability to the shock. If you have two places that say like they are one on the side of the other, right? Like they're very close, so they're equally vulnerable to the shock. And they were equally affected by the first blackout. But later on, you see that the government is deciding to ration in one, but not on the other. Right, like it wouldn't be because one is more vulnerable or one is harder to supply than the other. It's because there is some reason in sort of the government's utility curve or whatever they're trying to maximize. There's some reason that differentiates this place and this place that tells them we should ration here, but not ration here. We want to prioritize sort of the priorities of the regime. How's the regime making decisions? Are they giving carrots, right? This is on the carrot side. Are they giving carrots to the places where the military bases are because they're trying to prevent a military coup? Or are they giving carrots to the places where the dense areas of the country, because in the dense areas of the country, organizing protests should be cheapest? Or are they giving carrots to places where oil production is happening because oil production is vulnerable to access to electricity? You need to pump the oil out of the ground. So, and then you have concerns of actually getting access to foreign currency to, you know, provide imports and actually distribute rents and remain in control of the coalition of power. Are you protecting with carrots the poor areas of the country because you have a social concern? Are you protecting with carrots the places where your political base is because you're expecting that eventually the crisis is solved through an election and you want to keep your base of support like mobilized in favor of you? So these are all hypotheses that would very well explain part of the variation in that decision, but we're trying to assess which one is a more relevant factor in defining the regime's priorities, to sort of utilize this shock as an opportunity to assess the priorities of the regime. You know, suppose we were able to do away with the political situation, and we could have a government that would implement, because many of these things are not really political, are technical, right? And we had a regime that was capable and able to implement the technical solutions that are required. And what I mean capable is both in terms of human capital, which has been one of the main issues of the pre-crisis that was going right. Like everyone that had human capital was way more likely to leave the country earliest, right? Like the migration has been a migration of human capital in part. A big brain drain. So that's one side. But then the other side is access to the kind of resources and foreign currency support from international agencies to make the investments that you need to do in terms of equipment and infrastructure to sort of pick up the installed capacity that is already there, but that you need to like put to function adequately by importing the right pieces, transformers, etc. And in the end, I think that reestablishing access, so reestablishing the sustainability of this big power line that connects the Northwest to the Guri Dam, and being able to pick up the operational capacity of the thermopower plants that already exist in the country, right? Like getting somewhere much closer to the installed capacity in thermopower generation. That would be, I think, the ways to address the transmission and generation constraints that are now leading to that led to the regional blackout and that are now leading to the vulnerability of access to power in the northwest of the country. Now the issue is that we cannot do. We cannot do away with politics, and the current situation is a sort of a gridlock where the government's access to resources is very limited. But given the political priorities of the regime, we don't know if them having access to resources would lead to the right investment, technical investments to address the crisis, right? Like their political priorities have for long been aligned with this idea of how do we distribute rents so as to establish or to sustain, to guarantee the sustainability of the regime. And then there is this, you know, ongoing question of whether, you know, what's the right thing to do, right? Like limit the access to resources to promote the probability of regime change, and then, you know, once there's a legitimate a government in office that can actually talk to the international community to raise the necessary resources, then things would get addressed? Or should you actually just try to, you know, work with the regime? And that's where the question becomes more political.